Hi, everyone, and welcome to our 300th celebration here on PriorityOnePodcast.com on our Twitch channel at twitch.tv/PriorityOne. Thank you all for joining us in this celebration. 300 episodes, that's 5 years. That's a lot. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work.
So joining me right now, we have a nice... Is it 6 years? It's not six. Oh, it is 6 years.
50 episodes a year.
Yeah.
It's 6 years.
Yeah. That's a long time.
So joining me and Priority One and the rest of the team is Ken Ray and John Champion of Mission Log Podcast, a Roddenberry Star Trek podcast. Gentlemen, thank you so very much for joining us and celebrating with us this first part of our very long live day.
thank you. It's a true honor.
Why does everybody laugh?
That sounded totally sincere.
We're like a grandpappy podcast. I mean, we are doddering and ancient. He is just respecting his elders.
It's true, actually.
Thank you so much for that.
You're welcome. You're really, really welcome.
Well, again, thank you for spending your Saturday morning with us or Saturday afternoon, because like us, the two of you are on separate coasts, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
West Coast, East Coast. So, and it's only through the magic of editing that we all sound like we're all in the same place. So why don't we go ahead and just get started here a little bit? Let's talk a little bit about Mission Log Podcast and remind our listeners what it is that you guys present to the Star Trek community.
Oh, that old thing.
Mm-hmm.
So let's see. In a nutshell, Ken and I were forced together by Rod Roddenberry back in early 2012. With the idea of doing a Star Trek podcast to talk.
Oh.
To talk.
And then we launched in August of 2012, and we haven't stopped, you know, much to the chagrin, I'm sure, of some people.
Now it cut out a little bit there, so I'm not sure if you said what. So what are you guys? What is the goal and the overall? Go ahead, feed us that line.
Each week on Mission Log, we take apart an episode of each weekend episode. We
We've only done it 240 times.
Yeah, I know. How does it go? Each week on Mission Log, we watch an episode of Star Trek, taking it apart for messages, morals, and meanings, and trying to figure out whether the whole thing stands the test of time. That's sort of the idea. So we're going back and seeing, you know, if the stuff that they were trying to say, well, if they were trying to say anything, because sometimes they weren't, like cat's paw, or if they were on something like the Corbin Light Maneuver, or even shows that were made in the 20th century. I don't know why I'm suddenly reaching back to TOS. It's as if that was actually something I watched when I was growing up. So yeah, that's what we do, I think. Yes. And we have a computer that plays along with us, too. That's the other thing. But that's not a cast member, which we were called out for recently.
And some of our listeners, yeah.
Both that we have it and that we don't pay enough attention to it.
Right.
Kind of weird.
Yeah, it just depends on when you catch people. Yeah, I mean, I guess, you know, the whole thing started with the idea of Rod kind of coming out of Trek Nation and trying to figure out who his father was and what made him tick. And it was during that time that he sort of rediscovered Star Trek. He always talks about how he was raised as a Star Wars kid. But all his life, he kept hearing about how much Star Trek had impacted people and how much it meant to them. So he wanted to figure out a way to explore that, pick it apart, as Ken said, morals, meanings, messages. And he asked to do that, to kind of, you know, usher along that that part of examining what Star Trek means. So I guess, you know, we start out with a premise that Star Trek's important, mm-hmm. that people get something out of it, and it's our job to just sort of, I don't know, filter that a little, you know. I don't know that we're not really doing objective journalism by any stretch of the imagination. It's an opinion show, although we try to frame it in a way of saying, well, what do we think the writers of an episode were trying to say? And then by the time we wrap it up, do we agree with that? Do we not agree with that? Were the messages in there valuable? And as Ken said, do they actually stand the test of time? I think so far, most of those messages stand the test of time.
So this is actually kind of a big undertaking for you guys, and I'm sure you've covered this. It's going to take you something like, calculated before the addition of the new series, it was going to take you something like 14 years or something. That's kind of a big commitment. And now, remind me, how many episodes are you up to now? 200 and something, because I know you had your 200th a little while back.
216, I think, was.
Which places you in the middle of... so far. You're in the middle of the next generation. And of course, we're coming into the 30th anniversary year of TNG. Most of us kind of grew up watching TNG. And, you know, when we were kids, what's different about it now, watching it as a grown up, I guess, looking back on it?
That's interesting. What was the episode that we were watching recently? I Borg.
Yeah.
That was, I mean, it's hard to say that across the board, I mean, when you ask that question, because, I mean, it was all very sort of modern and yet sort of futuristic. And now when we watch it, John often talks about the bad hotel wallpaper in the background. So, I mean, it's weird because...
It needs to change.
There was a level of kitsch that we all knew about from TOS. Right, that we sort of thought we had lost when we got to TNG, but then now watching it 30 years later on TNG, it's like, wow, that hair, or all of that hair for like Troy's say, or like, you know, a carpet on the Enterprise, things like that. The big episodes, like when we watched I, Borg, when I was going back trying to figure out whether or not what they did was the right thing, or whether or not we thought what they did was the right thing, I kind of remembered that we were in like a really really sweet time geopolitically at that point. And I'm not, I have a friend who actually, you know, does stuff with governments, and he might argue with me about that. But as far as like us walking around, there weren't the constant worries about terrorism. We didn't even have a big bad enemy at the time, because, you know, the Soviet Union sort of fallen apart. So like they made that episode from this really like sort of cherry position of like, if there were theoretical enemies, here's how we should treat them. Now we watch it 30 years later, 25 years later for that episode, I guess. And it's sort of like more real world applicable. So I would honestly have to take it on a case by case basis. I mean, there are some episodes that are always going to be bad, like Angel One.
Love Angel One. Shut up.
That kind of earring is going to come in someday. That's going to happen. we're going to wear those. We are. Just watch.
You know, if there's one thing that we've learned from doing a couple of hundred episodes of Mission Log, it's what Kenna just pointed out, and that's that no matter what episode we talk about, it is always somebody's favorite, and it is somebody's least favorite.
Mm-hmm.
So we hear from all of them. You know, it's kind of interesting. Before we go into a show, we'll get emails saying, oh, I can't wait for you to get to this one because it is so wonderful, or it is so horrible, and I can't wait for you to pick it apart. And then we try very hard to be somewhat detached from that. You know, we can't ignore every email that comes in that has an opinion before we get to an episode. Well, Ken, I mean, you try very hard.
Some
exactly
of us can.
That.
You're right.
Yeah, right.
It just takes a little effort. You could do it if you wanted.
You could, yeah. But then we actually sit down to record. We try to push all of that aside and just treat it as something fresh. But then inevitably you hear from people who say, oh, I can't believe you are so critical of that, or I can't believe you praised that horrible piece of crap episode. You know, so it's we hear from every end of the spectrum. I think going back to what you just asked, something that I think is interesting just about the production of Star Trek, it's almost like this bell curve where you look at the original series and it's very energetic, it's very passionate, it's very sexy. And then you get into Next Gen. I kind of have to skip DS9 because I know the least about it, to be quite honest. So I'm really looking forward to picking that apart when we get there in about a year and some change. But then Voyager, like Next Generation, you kind of have this slope of the show becoming a bit more cold, a bit more clinical, a bit less passionate. But then you get to Enterprise, and I think rightfully so, they tried to strip that away and get back to this core idea of Star Trek of being, you know, humanity at this bold frontier. And what do we act like under extreme challenges? So I see Next Gen as having great characters and great ideas, but I also kind of cringe sometimes now watching in retrospect I've always said, they seem to not understand the idea of a wild party. And that kind of hurts me. You know, that is not a future that I want to live in necessarily.
Wait till you get to the DS9 wedding. Is it the wedding episode? There's some episode where the Fringies dance.
Is it? Okay. Oh. All right.
It's okay, man. Yeah. They have not forgotten the party.
Yeah. And if you ever get a chance to talk to Aaron Eisenberg about the Ferengi love dance, get that story off of him, because it's fascinating, complete with the butt wiggle, I believe.
Yep, that's right.
Nice. That particular dance actually has made it into Star Trek Online, which Wonderful. Is quite fun to do. Yeah.
You know, it's interesting that you bring up. You brought up Enterprise in that moment, and I don't know if you guys have put this together, have heard Connor Trinneer mention this. I just saw it in an interview that he had done at a recent convention about how Enterprise had come out just before 9/11 had happened, and it was because of 9/11 that they shifted their story to the Zindi attack, and that's where that influence came from. And I'm curious to see how Discovery coming now, you know, later this year, is going to address that kind of social, this, whatever is existing in social political atmosphere right now. You know, I mean, there's quite a bit to take from, and Enterprise did it quite directly. I mean, it was pretty much in your face, you know, how they handled that.
Where would you start today?
Right. Yeah. Where would you?
I mean, seriously, we had 9/11, and that was obviously a very pivotal moment. I can't even begin to think, like, if I were to sit down and say, okay, there is this one thing that we need to address, I would not even begin to know where to start if I only had one thing to do. But if you're going to tackle everything, then you're pretty much just doing a social work and space show at that point, aren't you?
Yeah.
Well, it's, the original series did it. I mean, they took on Vietnam, they took on racism, they took on automation and people being, you know, slaves to the machine, the slaves to the computer. I mean, they didn't. It's not like they were, you know, starved for ideas either. But they managed to, like, you know, just nibble at each one. And I don't know if with the more serial structure they're going to do on Discovery, if they're going to need to pick like Kim was saying, right, one thing and then go with it.
That's what I was thinking about, because the style of storytelling was so different. I mean, you know, you started with the premise 48 minutes, exception of the menagerie, of course, which is in two parts, and a private little war. That's actually always been one that sort of like makes me incredibly sad, but also I really sort of respected it, because generally speaking, they presented a problem and then they presented a solution. And we got to the end of a private little war and they basically said,
who knows?
I got nothing.
Yeah, nothing.
Yeah. Kind of got to keep this rolling the way it is right now so that it doesn't roll into something worse, which was really kind of a horrific message at the end.
You guys seem to figure out the best solution here. Okay, well, see you. Have good luck with that. Right.
Well, I think there's another thing here that's sort of the reality of how that show will be produced, how Discovery will be produced, and what their founding premise is. You know, when Ken and I were talking, gosh, I want to say it was back last summer, we did a supplemental show and we were talking about what our hopes were, what our expectations were for the next Star Trek. And I start from a position of saying, like, look, I don't care if it's animated, I don't care if it's live action, I don't care if it takes place in the 22nd century or 23rd or 24th. What you have to do is start out with great characters that we can relate to, that are being challenged in a way that has meaning. So whether it's about something that's a direct political parallel, which they may very well do, and that's fine. I think Enterprise handled that really nicely, but Enterprise was also around for a couple of years before they decided to go down that route. Enterprise already had really well-established characters. Mm-hmm. That's one thing that I quite like about that show, is that I think they were one of the best cast series of Star Trek. I think compared to Voyager, again, hard to say about Deep Space Nine, but overall, they had a really strong cast. So you could pretty much do anything with that cast. And once the decision was made to say, hey, we have these great characters that we're invested in, now let's see how we can push them. I don't know. I had a conversation with somebody online, one of our listeners, about this not that long ago. talking about the problem with sequel episodes in Next Gen. How does a good episode like Eye of Borg lead to something like Descent? Or how does, you bring back Tasha Yar for yesterday's Enterprise. How does that lead to Sela and the kind of the drop ball that we had with the Sela stories? And I said, look, I mean, to me, it's the idea that you're starting out with this premise, like, oh, we have this cool idea that people responded to. Now let's force the story on top of that. And I think that's the wrong way around. So,
yeah. Yeah, but that happens all the time. They absolutely keep making sequels to a good film until nobody buys the sequel anymore.
Truly, yeah.
I mean, I'm going to, Disney ones are exactly, there's like five Mulan stories.
Yeah.
Right? Part of that's commercial, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, and we're very picky as an audience. I mean, we want the same but different. And as soon as that happens, you leave it to the fan base to pick apart, well, what was too much the same and what was too different? So either way, you know, I don't want to be the guy who is handed the keys of the kingdom, as it were. Ken, I can't remember if you were on air or if this was after we did our Bob Worsey interview. And because, yeah, I remember him asking this twice. It was right after Into Darkness came out, when we did our interview with him. Nice. And at some point, it must have been off air. At some point, he said, where we're gearing up for the next one, what should we do? and I'm thinking, well, you're the writer. I'm not.
Yeah.
Did we actually answer that question?
Yeah.
Here's my card. I'm available. I'm free. I'm for hire. Yeah, right.
But, you know, I don't think that necessarily fans are the right ones to answer that question. Right, I want a writer who comes to it with a great story first and then says, okay, how do we fit this into Star Trek? Or how do we tell this in a meaningful way with Star Trek?
Yeah. Yeah.
John, can I ask you to possibly reconnect to the call? Is anybody else hearing that static?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Can I ask you to reconnect to the call? I don't know if it's a mic thing. Or I don't know what it might be.
It might be my connection going in and out. Oh, okay. I will be right back.
Cool.
Bye.
Let's see what happens. All right. Let's talk about it.
Right. What is those headphones, man?
You've got 30 seconds to ask me any question about John Champion you want to.
Let's see. How many suit jackets does he have?
I have no idea. You know my favorite one though. Yeah, let's talk about John, but we're gonna say nice things while he's out here. You ever seen that Nehru? You ever seen that Nehru jacket that he wears at the conventions?
Hey, I'm right here. Right here, Ken.
What I was actually gonna say is I love it, and I wish I could actually, I wish I could pull that off, but not like off you, don't misunderstand.
Whatever.
I wish I could pull that off. Yeah.
We only see each other once a year. You got to make it count.
So I want to take it back a little bit to TNG for a moment, because I mean, we're like, kind of said earlier, we're celebrating I was about to say 300, the 30th.
We are celebrating the 30th anniversary.
And Roddenberry.com is doing the Project 365, celebrating, getting all of that content out. What is the process that you guys do? This probably is more for John, because John, you're closer to Roddenberry and that archive. Do you go every week? Like, is it like once a month you go into this vault, you go into this archive and you grab all this stuff? And then also to that end, what have you found so far that has just been like, this is amazing. Look at this awesome artifact of TNG that we found so far that I just can't, this is amazing.
So quick point of clarification. So the discovered documents that we do on Mission Log are kind of one thing.
Okay.
And then Project 366/Project 365 is a different thing.
Yeah.
And there is an archivist at the office. His name is Ben. He's a hell of a guy. He's from Alabama like me. And his day job is to go through those archives and then pick out what'll be rolled out throughout the year under the Project 365 banner. And then that goes to social media to actually get it published. Now, what's nice is that I'm there, you know, a couple of times a week, and I get to see what he's working on. And the latest conversation that we've had, particularly with Next Gen, is that they've got a lot of behind the scenes photos and contact sheets and stuff like that that they did not have for TOS.
Yeah.
So you'll see a lot of that stuff coming out. Now, what I'm really interested in, and I think because our purposes are very different, they want to get this stuff out every single day on social media so people will interact with it. Now, when people come to Mission Log and they want to get a little behind the scenes information, it's really about, I think, creative process and development of the ideas that went into shows. So what I dig are things like memos, you know, show notes that come back from research. And what I have not published very much of that I think is really cool, so I want to get more into it. There's this drawer, there's this file drawer of just sort of random development notes for Next Gen. So we hit a point in our show in Mission Log where Gene Roddenberry had died. He passed away in, was it December of 91, early December of 91. So we've passed that where we are with the shows. So the number of memos has started to dry up. Mostly what I have now, if I go episode by episode, is a set of scripts, and those are not very exciting, you know, unless you really luck out. Like, we found Majel's script for The Cage with her handwritten notes in it. That was amazing. But a shooting script for an episode of Next Gen, simply not that interesting.
Right.
So all of that stuff is...
That's true for you, though. I think sometimes, I mean, because you're all Hollywood. There was a time at the convention, Star Trek Las Vegas, maybe 2014, I think, maybe even 2013, I don't know, where you had a stack of Generations scripts.
Yes.
And you were so nonplussed by the stack of Generations scripts. And I was actually kind of into it because I have not held that many movie scripts before. I mean, it wasn't like a shooting script or anything like that. It was a reprint, but still. So I was kind of into it, but then I bumped into somebody in line for some restaurant someplace, and she was bummed about something. I can't remember what. Don't remember who she is, anything, but she saw my script. She's like, oh, that's really cool. I gave it to her, and you would think that I had handed her Latinum or something. You'd think I'd handed her something absolutely amazing. She was so turned on by it. So, I mean, I wonder if you're...
Well, you're
it's
not talking
good
about
that we're having this discussion in front of a bunch of people. I wonder if you're a little too turned on. No, I'm not talking about your handwritten one. That was, yeah, if you ever get a chance, actually, he did make some amazing like notes in the edges that we had talked about turning it into something else.
Yeah, I'm currently sort of a long-term project of defacing that script and writing in character as Brandon Braga and Ron Moore. So that I'm trying to do that on every page. So that it kind of comes with me, and I'll do a little more, and then one day we'll auction it off.
Are you still working on that? Seriously?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. It's on the
show. Oh, dude, that's awesome.
Yeah.
I didn't realize. That's great.
Yeah. But no, I think it's just that from our point of view, it's something to run concurrent with the show. All I'd be publishing is a page that reads exactly as what you saw on screen. I think what's interesting is where there's a little change or there's maybe a discussion between writers or writers and research or writers and a producer to say, hey, why don't we do this instead? Or that scene doesn't work. So, yeah, I know. I mean, I know what you mean. Scripts are cool, but it would be a lot of the same if we kept running script pages. But what I was going to say, there's this drawer that's just full of development notes, and it's very unorganized. But that's the stuff that goes back to the beginning, where it's primarily Susan Sackett, David Gerrold, Bob Justman developing what will become the Next Generation. Gene didn't write a lot of memos. Mm. It seems like he communicated through other people, or he would give verbal notes and then that would get written up by somebody else. But going through that, and you see it all like printed out on a dot matrix printer, and that stuff is really cool. And I know that won't necessarily be run as part of 365. So what I want to do is, as we wrap up Next Gen, go back and pull some of that stuff that hasn't been seen yet.
Mm-hmm.
That and the weird memo with my casting tape on it. That was the other weird thing that showed up.
What?
Yes.
Yeah.
Your casting tape?
Yeah. So when I was acting more frequently, had the Wesley audition, then you don't know any details about it. 25 years later or something? And I found a memo that had a bunch of names on it that were on a casting tape coming from New York to LA. And I'm like, oh, look, Bebe Neuwirth, who won't relocate if she gets hired, so she's out of the running. There's my name on it for Wesley. So that was kind of cool.
He will drop everything he's doing in the moment to take this role.
Yes, yes.
That's awesome. I didn't know that, actually. I didn't know that you had auditioned for Wesley.
No, I didn't either.
That's an awesome piece of feedback. He's frozen. It was so epic that his Google Hangout completely froze.
Always leave them wanting more. Yeah. John knows this. Always leave them wanting more. So he just told the best story he has, and now we got 30 minutes to talk about him.
That's it. He's gone now.
No, it is actually. I'll tell the story for him because I've heard it a time or two. It's actually kind of amazing. He came home from school, and his mom was like, "Yeah, listen, you're packed. We're leaving." They actually flew to New York and did the thing, which is kind of cool. And it was, kind of nuts to hear him talk about. I think because I want to say he actually called me in the middle of the week, which seriously almost never happens. We talked during the show, and he's like, "So I just found this thing, which was." Which was his name in the Roddenberry archive.
Oh my God.
So do you remember the audition? Do you remember, is it vivid, the whole experience? No, who was sitting at the table? Do you know who it was? Do you remember it?
So here's the thing. My agent was in New York, not LA. Mm. So I had called them, and this was obviously pre-internet. So you hear some rumor of an inkling, hey, there's going to be a new Star Trek show. Mm-hmm. So I called my agent and I said, please get me an audition for this show. At the time, Gulf and Western owned Paramount, and they had a huge office in New York at Columbus Circle. So my mom picked me up from school one day and she said, we're not going home, we're going to the airport, you have an audition for Star Trek.
Wow.
Great. So we go to New York, we go to the Gulf and Western building. I did a reading, and I remember that the scene was Wesley talking. It was Wesley either talking to Riker about Data or talking to Data about Riker. And it had something to do with a book of Vulcan philosophy that one had given to Wesley. Now, I found those signs somewhere at Roddenberry. I didn't scan them, but I'll do that at some point. And I just remember doing the reading, thinking I did okay. We left, and I want to say later that day, I got a call back.
Wow.
Which was cool.
Nice.
So went back, and I remember trying to look at the other actors. There was nobody else auditioning for Wesley, but I was trying to look at the other actors, saying in my head, does that guy look like a Riker or a Data? And I'm pretty sure that nobody who I saw was anybody who got cast, because Frakes and Spiner and all, they were all living in L.A. at the time. Mm-hmm. And I felt good about the callback, and that was when they put me on camera. And then I'm sure soon after sent that out. So I remember that. I remember going into the building. I remember seeing all that. I remember trying to find out anything, because they don't tell you you didn't get it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, days later, weeks later, all right, are we going to hear anything?
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
But it was a cool experience, but it was weirder finding that memo,
uh-huh,
because then it became very real.
Right.
Because, yeah. A, it was a long time ago for me, and B, because I had heard nothing about it after, then suddenly to see it in black and white and go, oh, that actually happened. Mm-hmm. That was a little.
They thought about me after I left.
Right. Yeah. That was strange. That was really odd. Yeah.
That's very awesome, cool. Man.
John Champion could have been one of the most hated characters in Star Trek.
If only.
Shut up, Champion. That didn't happen, because then we wouldn't. Then we wouldn't have you now.
See, and I didn't audition for Neelix, so. Yeah.
Okay. It would have been funny if you had been Wesley and everyone would have called you Champ. Hey, K Champ, come on, way to go, Champ. Way to save the ship again.
Right.
Adults can't do nothing right.
Right. Right.
That's epic, man. That's epic. Mm-hmm. I'm like, man, I want to go through the trades and see if they're still auditioning for Discovery and see if I can try to get in.
But you have to be busy. Yeah, right. Probably be like the third alien from the left. I bet that's still open.
How dare you?
Hey, you've got a red shirt.
That's true.
Yeah. You're in.
Yeah.
That's what I always wanted to be. I always wanted to be an extra. I think those guys had it made because they just stood. They didn't have to remember any lines or anything. They just had to stand around looking, you know, Star Trek-y.
Since we're on video this week, we can do this now. Okay, everybody who wants to be on TV, show us your fear of death face and then, oh no, I'm dead face. Because red face is what you're going for.
No. I would have been totally like, I would have been, doing something on a pad or something. Yeah. I'm like,
show us your office worker face then.
My office worker face.
You got your phone handy, right? Just print your phone as a pad and, you know, and enter in some data.
Depressed.
She looks depressed.
What I want to do for my audition is I want to go stand back there and face away from the camera and just look over my shoulder every now and then.
Yeah. Right. See, that's exactly what I want to do.
Right.
Yeah.
Because that wouldn't be crazy. Just looking over my shoulder.
I mean, my personal favorite move is the Isaac. So it's the opening credits of Love Boat, and that's where you don't know there's a camera there, but then you recognize that there's a camera there, and then you acknowledge it. So it's like this. Right. It's like you, oh. So you, yeah.
That is spot on.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
But that's not an extra. You can't be a red shirt and do that. You can't be a red shirt.
No.
Bravo.
Clearly, like I was not cut out for Star Trek. Then
it's like Guy at the end of Guy does that at the end of the
yes at the end of Galaxy Quest.
Yes,
Galaxy
yes.
Quest. Yes. Thank you. Yeah.
Right.
That is his move.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, let's get Elijah apart. So Elijah, so you just come up. You're walking around a new planet. You know,
okay.
Minding your own business. So we need a minding your own business face.
If you don't know by now, this is my default face for everything. Right? That's what it is. That's right there. Right there. That's
which
the default.
Works? Which works on a brand new planet? That works on a brand new planet. Like, oh, that's a great rock. Oh, that's a new plant. Oh, that's oh my god! And then you die. Okay, let's see this. Go.
Oh, I'm dead? Oh, okay.
No. You're dead at the end, but at first you're like just your eyebrow. That's your default.
No,
mode.
Again, it's dead. Dead would be this. that's all. I just chill like that.
That is so like, you know, the guy is hired to play the corpse there, that wants to
there,
get noticed. That
there
is
might be that there might be a little bit of a twitch, like a last minute, like rigor mortis, just before rigor mortis. All right, that's getting.
Anyway.
Okay, that's all getting cut. That's all getting cut. Blooper reel. Totally.
Yeah, totally. I actually wanted to ask you, both of you, John and Kent. So you've had several years of a lot of episodes. Some are better and worse than others. But I wanted to ask you guys, like, what's your favorite totally like off the wall thing that you've noticed or found or seen? Because I'll give you an example. This is my favorite. Is Worf's ball chair. Is
I have
my
one in my house.
Favorite. You know,
should
really
sit on it?
Weird random thing.
I'll be right back.
You know, every
he's gonna get us.
Does he have a ball chair?
No. He tells. He said he has a ball chair.
He said right. He has one.
Oh man.
He's not going to demonstrate it, is he?
It's Tony. Yeah. Listen, I'm just glad Tony's wearing pants. As he walked away, I'm just glad he's wearing pants. So.
Every now and then, something gets said on the show which takes on a life of its own. Sometimes those are intentional. Sometimes they're not. Yeah,
that happens to us a lot.
Yeah, yeah, right. We had, and I'm blanking on the name right now, but we had a listener who did an amazing job at pulling together the mission log glossary. If you go to our website, and it's all the little things that are recurring in mission log, going back to you see Temi, I think that was one of the first things that we really established right from the beginning. And I remember getting email from people saying, I don't understand, why are you saying you see to me? We're like, no. It's you see Temi. We're in the guise of like a 1950s TV show aimed toward kids, teaching them a lesson, you know. So we little things like that had to explain what we were doing. Have a look at my robot guts, still for some reason has a life of its own.
That was a great line. A lot of those things that were actually born of like the listeners doing stuff, like so it was in not Planet. Is it Planet Mud? It's not called Planet Mud, is it? What is that movie called? Or what is that
there's called? There's iMud, Mud's Women, and Mud's Planet. You're talking about animated?
I think it was, the one where you said, take a look at my robot guts. It was Norman.
iMud, sorry.
iMud, right. Okay, so Norman turns out to have been a robot, and it's just in the recap that John said, take a look at my robot guts. And we came out of it, and I was like, man, I would so buy that T-shirt. and I think it was I can't remember who it was, but somebody like after that episode dropped, like about an hour and a half later, we got that art. Same thing with it. I have a T-shirt for the Ditalix Mining Corporation, and again, it was exactly the same thing where I just said, man, I so want, like, I want Ditalix stationery, I want Ditalix T-shirts, and somebody did write back with a T-shirt seriously the day the show dropped. Which was, I mean, so things like that are kind of amazing. I mean, most of the things that, if you're talking about the stuff that came out of our show, I mean, we're never like, okay, this is going to be a thing. It's just like all of a sudden it ends up being a thing, like the lawyer and a shower curtain, or the power of positive thinking for negative results. That's another one that I really like. That's my favorite. I will push that one forever.
Oh, and remember, somebody did a book cover for Commodore Decker. And I forgot exactly what it was, but we had something about his command style, and then
we mentioned something about his management style. Yes,
right.
Didn't somebody did one for Cybok as well?
Yes,
I want to say.
Right,
I can't remember what it was. Release your pain, or something like that. Give me your pain, or something along those lines.
So it's weird what kind of takes on a life of its own. I mean, when we alternate writing the recap of the episodes, and sometimes the inspiration will just sort of be there. Like you're going along, just sort of writing a rough plot outline, and then a song comes on in iTunes. You're like, oh, okay, I'm now going to rewrite this with all song lyric references, or I'm going to rewrite this with video game reference. And it's just like us amusing ourselves. In fact, it was
for you, don't do it. That's the credo of the podcaster right there. None of this preparation is the cornerstone stuff. It ain't fun. I quit.
Well, it's so funny that just the other night, so we're getting the next phase ready to output. And Ken has his job and I have my job, and then they kind of come together approaching midnight on a Wednesday night. And none of this came up in the episode at all. But as soon as I said next phase to myself, it was like, oh, okay, well, now all the lyrics to Billy Joel's Still Rock and Roll to Me are in my head. And they won't stop being in my head unless I write it down. So that became
a phrase anyway.
Yeah. So then that became a part of the show description. But then it also became a part of the show. And the computer went insane just spouting off lyrics, and that's how it happens.
Yeah, usually at a
fever state computer. About 11 p.m. on a Wednesday night.
So you guys go ahead, Ken.
11 p.m. on a Wednesday night weeks ago, because we're never just editing the show right up until the minute it comes out.
No,
nothing like that would ever happen ever.
Neither with us, right, Winters?
Yeah.
I know. I just got yelled out for not having a specific time.
The time drop, yeah.
Right. Yes. Yeah. We'll pick that up offline, Elijah.
we say Monday, right? Ken, I saw your you raised the brow like I'm the brow. We say Monday, but we don't. We try to get it out by like early a.m. on Monday. And Kenna yelled at me for what are you doing in the afternoon? It has to be a certain time. And her voice went into that kind of, it went just like that. It was scary.
For my, for my daily show that I do, it's done when it's done and it's out when it's out. It never comes out before midnight Pacific, but it might not come out until 5 a.m. Pacific. It just depends on when I actually finish the show. Mission Log and most any other show that I'm on, I mean, it should have a drop dead time. We actually did miss it by about 30 minutes this week, but it's midnight, Wednesday night, Thursday morning on
Elijah
the West
Coast. Got a video, I told you so.
But here's the thing, most people don't even notice. I mean, that's the other thing, too. I mean, people who are used to it being there at a certain time know that it's there at a certain time.
Important, clever people notice.
Well, it's happening at, you know, midnight Pacific time, but there's one guy in Reykjavik who's up just waiting for that show to drop.
Mm. Oh, please. There are like 5 people in the UK.
There are. For real.
Yeah.
So, worldwide audience of over a dozen. That's what we the priority one.
Exactly. You know, speaking of, Priority One celebrating its milestone, you guys had a 200th milestone as well. In the years that you've been doing it, you know, we're pushed by our listeners, you know, like this is very much now become a dialogue with them. And we've had some great experiences with them. Are there any moments that you can recall with a listener either at a convention or offline that just kind of stands out to you?
Yes.
Moving on.
Okay.
One of those.
What's yours, John?
In Vegas.
No, it's interesting to hear from people online, and then meet them in real life, because some people who I feel like are either you can't read their tone online, or they're a little, I don't know, just maybe taking things a little too seriously online. But then you meet them in person and you kind of drop your guard a little bit and relax and see each other as human beings. I've had that experience a couple of times, which is nice. What's really interesting to me is when we'll be at a convention and we will see the same people now for 4 years straight.
Mm-hmm.
And very often they will come up and kind of say the same things to us. Which sometimes is along the lines of, I still disagree with everything you say, but I still listen to the show, you know?
A lot of people like argue with the radio.
They like the what?
Argue with the radio.
Oh, yeah. Mm. Yeah. And we try to remind people, at least I try to remind them online, saying, you know, this show is not a competition. It's not an encyclopedia. We're not telling you exactly what you should take. It's just us. It's just me and Ken trying to figure out what we think is going on here. Mm-hmm. If you think something different, that's great. And if you think that a lot and you feel like you need to get it out to the world, then please say it on our website or start your own podcast. It might be a great opportunity for you, you know? But yeah, I mean, I don't want to go too much into specifics about meeting people, but I don't know, there are a few that stand out. I know for you as well, Ken, you know, we see people year after year.
There were two things that stick out for me. There was one, and it's all just interpretation, right? I'm watching an episode and I hear something in it, and a lot of times I'll see or hear something in an episode that John doesn't, and vice versa. We got an email from somebody recently, and I won't go into it because it's not my story to tell, but he actually said that something that we said had changed his life for the better. And to hear his story, it's actually ridiculously humbling to think that we could have even had a part in something like that.
Right.
The moment that I don't feel weird at all sharing is we did have somebody who, when he heard that we were going to be at the Star Trek convention, he and his—I can't remember his wife or girlfriend—were doing a Southwest and West Coast road trip, and when they heard that we were going to be in Vegas, he rerouted his trip because he wanted us to sign his Star Trek wallet.
Yeah,
and that was weird because he knew that there was a Star Trek convention. and we weren't in Star Trek, but he went ahead and replotted his course so that we could sign his wallet. And that's like, okay, we have a friendship that I don't even know about. That's kind of a neat, that's kind of a neat thing, right? I mean, there's an intimacy around radio and around even more so, I think, around podcasts, because radio, it's sort of like, well, if I'm up every morning at 7, then I'll listen to the same DJ and that's great. There's a different thing about podcasts, though, because, I mean, we started joking about a year ago or maybe a little bit less. We are your Star Trek pals. And that's the thing. We are. I mean, you guys are, too, certainly. But, I mean, we're always there whenever somebody catches us. And, like, I would imagine we still constantly get emails from people who say, found your show 6 months ago and I just caught up. That's 200 something episodes, dude. But you know,
episodes to catch up on.
People drive cars a lot.
It's true. Yeah, right. It's an amazing thing. Or they have, like, you know, there are plenty of people that we hear from, honestly, who have like data entry jobs and things like that, where they can just listen to something else. It's really strange, the relationships that we have that we're not even aware of.
Mm-hmm. You remember at the convention this past year, Ken, when the guy came up with, it was like a 1973 Lincoln Enterprises news. And I'm looking,
wait.
Wow, you're going to let me.
I'm sorry, John, you cut out at the description of what it was he brought up to you.
No, he said, okay. I remember it though, and I do, so don't worry about it.
He brought like a 1973 newsletter from Lincoln Enterprises.
Oh, okay.
And I thought that was cool. And I just, to hold it, I thought, wow, thank you. You're letting us touch this artifact. That's great. And he wanted us to sign it. And he took it to some of his other favorite podcasters. I think it was Dan and Bill from Trek Geeks. Love those guys. Yeah. And he was saying, you know, I'm taking this around to the people who mean something to me now, vis-a-vis Star Trek. And I that was amazing. It's like, it's what Ken is describing. Like, it's this sort of family of people that you don't even know about. These friendships you don't even know about.
Yeah. Awesome. And again, we continue on into 2017. Any plans for 2017? Anything you got on the docket?
One or two.
Well, you guys are as cryptic as the cryptic devs with your
yeah.
Well, we have stuff planned for the next year, but we can't tell you about it.
We want to actually do
in celebration of TNG, you know, conventions, things like that. What, you know, what's on the docket?
I can tell you that Vegas for sure.
Yeah.
I can tell you that we're also kind of always looking at what conventions would have some impact. Ken, you and Elijah, you did Northeast Star Trek in Albany.
I don't even remember what it was called.
There was a Star
Northeast Trek Con.
Northeast Trek Con in Albany, New York.
In Albany. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was a tremendous amount of fun. It was a very, very, very small show, but we got to connect with, a lot of the people that were there repeatedly, which, I mean, sort of makes it sound like, if that sounds bad at all, I don't mean for it to. It was an amazingly intimate gathering, I would say. I mean, like, you go to Vegas and it's like, hey, there's that person at that table, there's that person at that table, and you see them, but you don't necessarily get to talk to them. We got to hang out with J.G. Hertzler and Rick Sternbach and Michael Jan Friedman. Is that right? It was neat to hang out with Elijah, honestly. And then the people that we talked to, I mean, the people who came up as well, I mean, it was exactly what I hoped it would be, people who didn't know about either of our shows. And so we were able to kind of make that connection that way, which was something. So I personally would like to see, you know, do a bunch more smaller shows, but
yeah,
I don't know.
Yeah, it was this, you know, to echo that too, actually, as a matter of fact, there was one gentleman that we were talking to who had played Star Trek Online years ago and then just got back in. And I've been recently playing again over the holidays, and I open up my in-game mail and it's the guy. And he's like, hey, you know, we met at the Northeast Convention in Albany. Can I get a fleet invitation? It's things like that with the smaller conventions that allow for that kind of, that intimacy definitely helps, right? Because it allows almost a networking where they then share it with their friends, and it becomes a more dynamic experience for the listener.
Yeah.
And it was cool hanging out with you too, Ken.
Yeah, that was fun.
And I can tell you this, you know, Roddenberry wants to do more with podcasting in the coming year. And whatever shape that will take, we've looked at a lot of opportunities, and we're still kind of kicking that around. I think Ken and I know that we'd both be insane if we ignored the fact that Discovery is coming out in a few months. So, you know, something to be said, something to be done around that. We'll figure out exactly what that might be. And you know, and you guys, priority one, not so bad yourselves. Maybe maybe some opportunity for a little more collaboration down the road.
Cool. We'd love that. Absolutely.
I think we would all love that.
Have your people call John's people.
All right.
Yeah, sorry. Man, I'm Elijah's people. Man, this is like work.
Awesome. Well, guys, I don't want to take up, you know, so much of your day. I want to thank you for stopping by here and celebrating our 300th with us. It's a real honor to have you. You guys are great. So fun to talk about Star Trek, talk about our shows, talk about the experience that is Star Trek for us. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having us. Seriously.
Absolute pleasure.
All right. Thank you. We're going to take a quick little break. We will be right back shortly. I guess I'm gonna have to cut the stream because I don't. Oh no! You know what? Yeah, I'm gonna just switch over to scene two, and let's just see what happens there.